Hi friends, I am Saranamurthy, the History Faculty of the Shankar Academy. Since few days are there for your preliminary exams, that on June 2nd, an attempt was made by me how to approach the history preliminary questions. Since it's a static subject, nearly 15 plus questions are being asked. That too in 2018, as many as 21 questions had been asked by UPSC in civil services exams. Attempt was made that too in the modern India questions, because in 2019, they asked 11 or 12 questions in the modern India. Here, how to approach such a modern India questions and what are the various types of questions in modern India? That approach I try to answer, I try to explain here. Many students are thinking that if the question is very simple, just one line is there and three, four answers are given and just not more than that, two, the answers are not more than one or two lines, they are thinking that that is the easiest questions. No, this is a very wrong approach. But then what is the easiest question is, if you go through, some questions would be there in this, the lengthiest statement. The statement itself is the lengthiest, and they have given 1, 2, 3, so-and-so, and then they have given A, B, C, D, right? This is 1 and 2, then 2 and 3. Actually, this is the easiest question. Actually, question is easiest and the toughest, not related to the words and the lengthiness of the questions, rather than here how many choices have been given. Why I am saying this one is, in this question, if this question is very simple, means just one line, means it's very toughest. Here, it's they have not given any clues. But here, if it's a lengthiest question, they have given many clues, right? Here, you could easily use the elimination process. For example, if four statements are given and you are asked to choose what's the right thing means, right, no need to have all the things to be known. If you know the fourth statement is wrong, you could easily eliminate. After eliminating this one, you straightly come to the choice. Definitely four would be there, either here or either here. So three and four. Otherwise, two and four only means you could easily strike out this. So this is what? So answering a question, whatever, whether it's a history topic or whatever the topic, first you must have such an approach. So question is simple means they have not given any kind of clues. So UPSC will test you psychologically also. Yes, even modern India has such a questions also. When we are entering into the questions, then let me explain how to answer such a questions. So first kind of questions is simple, and many are thinking that this is the toughest one, but it is the easiest to answer. Only thing, you have to read at once. If you read at once, you will come to know about the answer very easily. It's a one approach. And the second thing normally a student has difficult is 2 to 3 questions would be there simultaneously. 2 to 3 questions would be toughest, lengthiest, followed by easiest one. First, the student will consider, will go through that questions and would get nervous, and when come to answer the easiest one, they would commit the mistakes. You always keep it in mind, there are 100 questions are there. No need to attend all that. It's difficult to attend all the 100 questions, right? So you always keep it, even if you don't know first 10 questions or 20 questions, remaining 80 questions are yours. With this approach, you entered into the hall. With this approach, you face each questions, that too in the history questions, right? Definitely, you will clear the prelims. So first set of question is simple, straightforward. Second is toughest. Many are considering this is the toughest, but actually this is the easiest one. And third kind of questions is the chronological order. Chronological order will be asked. For that, you have to study not the years. You have to study the stories. Then only you would come to know how this answer to these kinds of questions. In the case of chronological order, right, many are thinking that, for example, Crisp Mission is there, Augustofer is there. You must know the exact year of the Crisp Mission. You must know exact year of the Augustofer. No need. Crisp Mission or Augustofer, what happened is, when Second World War was started, the ministers resigned, that Congress refused to have the full support to the British government to give some offer to the Congress, Augustofer. You study like this, not necessarily Second World War was started in 1939, Augustofer in 1940. Then what happened is, during the course of war, to get the full support, Cripps Mission was sent. When Cripps Mission was failed, Quit India Movement. Cripps Mission and Quit India Movement took place in the same year. How far would you remain and would you study and by heart the years again and again? So that's why many are thinking that you have to study the years. No, you study the story and have an idea, you could easily arrange any kind of questions in a chronological way. So first you have such a mind. With this, I will give some set of questions, how to approach it. Let us enter into the one by one question. So first, come to the first question. What was the immediate reason for the Amur Shah Abdali to invade India and fight the third battle of Panipat? You all knew very well that three battle of Panipat. A slight significance is there. First Panipat 1526, second is 1556, and third is the 1761. So here is the first, here the second, and here is the third one. It's quite interesting. There is a famous statement is there. The first two battle determined who should rule India. The third battle determined who should not rule India. Because in the first battle, the battle was between Babur and Ibrahim Lodi. In this, Babur conquered, that led to the establishment of Mughal rule. In the second battle, it was between Akbar versus Hemu. In that, Akbar got victory, and the second battle determined who should rule India, that is Akbar. But in the case of third battle, it was between the Afghans and the Marathas. It's a very interesting thing. After this, neither Afghans nor Marathas ruled India, rather than that led to the rise of the British. So it's a quite interesting related to the third battle of Panipat. All knew very well that that took place in 1761. So the question is, what was the immediate reason for the Amur Shah Abdali to invade? You just go through this. Four lengthy statements are there. He wanted to avenge the expulsion by the Marathas of his viceroy Taimur Shah from Lahore. The frustrated governor of Julandhar, Adina Beg Khan, invited him to invade. He wanted to punish the Mughal administration for non-payment of the revenue of the Chahar Mahal, that is that for Gujarat, Aurangabad, Sialkot and the Parsur. He wanted to annex all the fertile land of Punjab up to the borders of the Delhi to his kingdom. You knew all very well that the intention of Abdali was not to annex the major part of India. He wanted to loot. He almost invaded six times in 1750s, very similar to 700 years before Mahmud of Ghazni invaded 17 times. His intention was to plunder. So if he knew the basic idea, you could remove the D option. It's very easy to remove the D option. And you come to the C. He wanted to punish the Mughal administration for non-payment of revenue. Okay, up to this was good. But what happened is this Aurangabad, it's impossible to have that Aurangabad, that area. So that's why you could easily eliminate the C option. So even though if you don't know, right, the particular matters of the Amur Shah Abdali, if you knew the basic thing, you could eliminate C and D. Now you come to the A and B alone. Now, the frustrated governor of Julandhar, Adina Beg Khan, invited him to invade Punjab. Actually, this is what was the major cause of the first battle of Panipat. The first battle of Panipat between Babur and Ibrahim Lodi. Babur versus Ibrahim Lodi. In that, one of the descended governor of the Ibrahim Lodi, that is the one of the Lahore governor, he invited. So he invited Babur. So this statement, if you studied the first battle of Panipat, you could. So Adina Beg Khan never invited him. So now you come to this. He wanted to avenge the expulsion of Maratha of his viceroy Taimur Shah. Actually, here question, who was Taimur Shah? Was none other than the son of Ahmad Shah Abdali. The events goes like this. Abdali invaded many a times and he captured the Lahore region and made his own son Taimur Shah as the viceroy of that region. In between gap, the Marathas were expanding from this area, that too under the great leadership of the Peshwa, Balaji Bajirao. Before that, Bajirao was there. It was during the Balaji Bajirao, the Maratha had an idea. What kind of idea? Mean, we wanted to conquer the territory from Katak. Katak is here, Attack is here. So this is what their concept. The Maratha territory should be between the Katak to Attack, this much. With this intention, the Maratha started to conquer and started to collect the taxes, right, from the outside area. What happened is the Maratha Sardars invaded the Lahore and expelled the Taimur Shah. The son immediately went and complained it before the Ahmud Shah Abdali. Ahmud Shah Abdali invaded in 1761. That led to the third battle of Panipat. So this is the method of studying. If you know the events rather than the year, it's very easy to answer by having the story itself rather than bihatting the years. This is the method. Okay, let us move on to the next questions. I will give it. And the second question is very interesting. Recently, these kinds of question has not been asked by the UPSCs, but in other exams, these kinds of question has been asked. That is the assertion and reason. When we were writing, these kinds of question has been asked, but now, especially after 2010, these kinds of question has not been asked by UPSC. I expect that at any time, this assertion reason question may surface, may again be asked by the UPSC. So how to answer this assertion reason question? Okay. So first, before entering into the question, a brief idea related to the assertion reason. So assertion means it's like a fact. It's a pure factual information. Reasoning means whether that reason substantiate this fact or not, that you have to check it. So this is statement number one. This is the statement number two. It's a factual information. What is the reason means you have to check it, whether the reason, right, whether the reason reasonably explain this fact, that is the assertion, or not. That alone you have to go through it. Let me go through the question, then I will check, I explain it. Shalam to spend the initial years as an emperor outside Delhi. Yes. You all knew very well that an incompetent ruler, that too in the later Mughals, incompetent ruler, Shah Alam, 1750s and up to 1800s, nearly for 50 years he ruled, but without any power, incompetent one. Outside the Delhi, the second thing, yes, initial years, that too spend outside Delhi, then what place? It's Awadh. Why? Now the question arises, here is the Mughal rule. Here is the Awadh kingdom. Rather than having his seat at Delhi, why did he spend major that initial years in the Awadh? Means two reasons are there. One is internal disturbances within the Mughal. Another one reason is the external aggression. And another reason is the frequent raid of the Marathas into the Delhi region. So these three reasons. One is internal disturbances within the Marathas. That too, the overpowered nobles were responsible. Another thing is the Marathas. And another thing here, who are the expansionists? The intruder is the Afghans. So this is a method of study in the 1700s. So 1700s, the Maratha started to decline. Mughals started to decline. Maratha started to rise. And the rise of regional kingdom, here is the Awadh, here is the Bengal, here is the Hyderabad. And simultaneously, the external aggression, even before Afghans, Nadir Shah invaded, then Abdali invaded. So with this, in this scenario, what happened to the Mughal ruler? So Shah Alam too spent initial years as an emperor outside Delhi. Yes, that too in the Awadh region. Why? There was always lurking danger of foreign invasion from northwest. No doubt at all. There was a danger. No doubt at all. This is one of the things. But when compared to this, right, the Marathas and the more is the internal disturbances, that too he was disturbed by the nobles. The nobles virtually took the powers. They became the power mongers and they threatened Shah Alam too. That's why he escaped to the Awadh region. And at last, why not? In 1806, he was killed by one of the nobles. That was a pathetic end of the Shah Alam too. Okay, so when compared to the external invasion, here the most problem is the internal disturbances. So first one, Shah Alam to spend the initial year as an emperor outside Delhi. Second, there was a always. Here these kinds of words you have to go through. Always, all, many, almost all. So this is the key word, you have to check it. So remaining is right, lurking danger of the foreign invasion. This is one of the cause, but not the only thing. So here reason is false. Assertion is right, statement one is right, this statement is wrong. This is what. Now you come to the quotes option. Both A and R are true, and R is the correct explanation part of A. Keep it in mind, here R itself is wrong, so not this one. Both A and R are true, but R is not a correct explanation of the A. But here if you see, sometime this may be right, this may be right. Okay, that's what they have given. Both are true, but R is not a correct explanation. But what happened here, R itself is wrong, so second choice is wrong. Now come to A is true, R is false. Yes, exactly suitable to our question. That's why this is right. A is false. No, A is the correct statement. So R is not, D is not the right one. Here answer is the C. So in this questions, I expect that it may be resurfaced. This is called assertion reasons. So in this, A is true but R is false. Okay, sometimes assertion right, reason is right, but sometimes the reason not necessarily to explain the assertion means you have to go through the B option. Okay, so this is the method of approaching the assertion reason topic, though nowadays it has not been asked. At any point of time UPSC may resurface such questions. Move on to the next one. Yes, this is what, this simple question, which one of the following was the first fort constructed by the British in India. This is what normally a student would commit. Once they got the GS paper, they would go on to search what is the easiest. For them, they are considering that easiest means a single line. No, it's very toughest, because you must know the very concrete. Fort Williams, Fort St. George, Fort St. David, Fort Angelo. Where was it? That's no other, any other clue. Even many don't know where such a things are built. So with this, you have to. So this is a simple question with question wise. But if you go through the answer, right, you must know the very clear cut. Here, if you studied means, no doubt at all, what is the answer is the B. It's a Fort St. George located at Madras. That's a right one. It was started to construct in 1640s. That to fight the Francis Day. Francis Day, the then governor of the Madras, he was responsible for construction of this fort. He got a land, later he started to construct a fort. First the fort was developed, and nearby a township was developed, that is none other than present day one of the metropolitan city called Chennai. So this is the answer. Fort Williams, you people know very well about that. This is located in Calcutta, but it was constructed much later. It was constructed around 1700s. Now you come to the Fort David, that is located at a place called Kadalur, just 200 km, 150 km south of Chennai, near Pondicherry. This Kadalur is there, that David Fort, Saint David was constructed. And this one is the Angelo Fort is there. This fort was located at the constructed by the Portuguese. By the Portuguese at Kananur. There is a place called Kananur. In that, the Fort Angelo was constructed by the Portuguese. This is one of the earliest fort built by the Europeans. So here, two new things you have studied. Fort Williams, St. George is very even. Fort St. David is located at Kadalur, and Angelo is located at the Kananur. It's also called Kananur Fort by the Portuguese. That is the Portuguese very famous governor general Alfonso de Albuquerque. He constructed this Angelo Fort. Later it was attacked by the local Kerala rulers. So this much of information you must know, then only you could answer such a question. But the question is very simple, easy, but answer, right, yes, seems to be easy. Without knowing this much of information, it is difficult. Okay, this is the third set of questions UPSC will ask. Next, move on to the next one. Another thing, one of the simplest seems to be that, but you should have studied it. These kinds are have been given. Who among the following Englishmen first translated Bhagavad Gita into English? Actually, this is given in the NCERT book itself. That in the ancient NCERT itself, this kind of explanation part is given. So you should know who is William Jones, Charles Wilkins, Alexander Cunningham, John Marshall. After that, a brief idea, then only you could answer this one. So what's answer of this is, that's a Charles Wilkins. He translated into the this one, Bhagavad Gita into English. And then what about William Jones, Alexander Cunningham and John Marshall? Yes, William Jones was responsible for building Asiatic Society of Bengal, a very famous organization. Even recently 2017 or 18, a question has been asked. So here expected is, who translated Bhagavad Gita into English? This may be asked in this preliminary question itself. And now come to the C and fourth, Alexander Cunningham and John Marshall. These two are related to the ASI, Archaeological Survey of India. This Alexander Cunningham was the first DG of ASI, because ASI was established in 1861 during the Lord Canning period. Lord Canning period, ASI was established. The first Director General of ASI was Alexander Cunningham, and this John Marshall. John Marshall was the DG, Director General, around 1920s. Then what's the significance of this John Marshall? He was responsible for exploring the Indus Valley Civilization or Harappan Civilization. Under the aegis of this fellow, right, various places were excavated. He is highly responsible for exploring India's past culture around 1920s. So if you know this kind of information, then only you could answer these kinds. That's why again and again saying, previous questions the clues has been given. In this question, the clue has been given. In this, just you have to go through with the basic thing you could answer. But in this area, you must know, especially question number 3 and question number 4, you must know this much of information, then only you could answer. Next, shall we on to next one? Recently, this question has been asked. Karl Marx explained the process of class struggle with the help of which of the following theories? Actually, this is more or like many are considering this a world history or might have studied in some other optionals, but once this has been asked in the GS itself. Though you don't have an idea, you could try. Though it seems to be the toughest, if you study the basic aspect of the economic history of India, you could answer these kinds. So Karl Marx is related to socialism and communism. So if a communism means grouping rather than individualism, it's a grouping concept. So with this, we are going to approach it. In this, you come to the first, empirical liberalism. Actually, liberalism word is not at all related to the Karl Marx. So you could try in this, maybe sometimes it's a hard guess, you could try here, empirical liberalism, no. And existentialism, actually existentialism is related to the individualism. It's an individual approach, how the individual will be treated rather than the grouping. So you could avoid this one. Darwin's theory of evolution, definitely it's not related to this. It's a theory of evolution, survival of the fittest. These kinds of approaches were followed by the fascist approach. So you could eliminate this one. And last one, remaining thing is there, dialectical materialism. So this dialectical materialism give an explanatory idea about the class struggle. So what is dialectical materialism? In this means simple, dialectical, it's here too, materialism, right, is there. So what is dialectical materialism is, Marx tried to explain in what way mean when the stages of history change from one stage to the next stage, always there would be the two classes and fight between these two classes. So this is the class one and this is the class two. Right, this class one have class, this class two is the have not class. Always the history evolved from one phase to another, there was a clash between haves and have nots. For example, Marx tried to put that in that ancient period, there was have class is the master and have not class is the slave class. And medieval, it's a feudal lord and serf. And modern, here the capitalist and the working class. So this kind, so haves and have nots with respect to land or with respect to the capital, these groups are called materialists. One is the materialist, another is not materialist. So when the age change, always two kind of groups and clash between these two groups. This concept is called class struggle. That idea is called dialectical materialism. In his famous book called The Communist Manifesto, he tried to explain that. That Communist Manifesto was written in 1848 when he was in Paris. In this Communist Manifesto only, he tried to explain dialectical materialism. In that, he mentioned about the class struggle. So this is the UPSC early previous year question. You have to know about this. Next one. Consider the following statement. The Government of India Act 1935 provided for the provincial autonomy. Yes. Establishment of the federal court. Yes. You all knew very well. And All India Federation at center. Yes. That is also the right one. So here, why I took this question is that Government of India Act 1935 is very important, because nearly 50% of the present or major source of the present constitution was taken from this part. In this only, the provincial autonomy, because in 1919 Act, the provinces were given diarchy system, but the diarchy system was not at all suitable. It produced ugly result. That's why when Simon Commission was appointed, one of the strong recommendation of the Simon Commission was to abolition of this diarchy system. And accordingly, in 1935 Act, diarchy system was abolished. Instead, provincial autonomy was given. That too, complete autonomy means no. That's a different kind of matter. Not complete autonomy, though the governor had all such a power. So here, the provincial autonomy was given. The establishment of federal court, no doubt at all. Later, it became the Supreme Court. Yeah, when it came to exist in 1950, became the Supreme Court of India. So, the federal court. But that's a difference between the federal court then and Supreme Court now. Now, the Supreme Court is the highest authority, judicial authority. But the federal court that was established in 1935 was not the highest court. Then what is the highest court of appeal? Means here, this is what the simple. High courts are there. Above that, federal courts are there. Federal court is there because only one. Even if you are filed, your case is defeated in that federal court, you could take it to the next level, that is the Privy Council. That's why. But now, Supreme Court, with this, Supreme Court, here the High Court. So, once the matter is taken to the Supreme Court, that's all. After that, there is no court as of now. But here, 1935, federal court was established, but it is not the highest court of appeal. You could take your matter to the Privy Council. It's the second, federal court. All India Federation. Now I come to the third, All India Federation, right? The British tried to establish an All India Federation. In that, they wanted to include the province, that to governor's province. That's a more or less, what's a governor's province mean? Big provinces, and some other provinces are there. These are the commissioner's province. These are all the commissioner's province. What's the difference between governor's province and commissioner's province mean? If the provinces are too big, it's a governor's province. If it's very small and strategic means, it's a commissioner's province. This commissioner's province is now more or less equal to union territory. It's a second. And the third category is the princely states. So, representations from governor's province, commissioner's province and from the princely state, and wanted to set up the All India Federation. This is what. Even the princely states were allowed to send the representatives. Though the act maintained about the All India Federation, the act didn't, it was not come into force because the princely state refused to send its representatives. So, all the three statements are correct. Here, the answer is the D. There will be an economic related question, history, that to either related to the land revenue system, otherwise drain of wealth, are related to the rural peasant. These are all the economic history. Normally, many would concentrate on the political topic, political history. No doubt, this is also a part and parcel, but this alone is not the history. Actually, history, it consists of political part, economic history, social history, cultural history, and the national movement phase. So, many would concentrate on this. So likewise, you concentrate on this part also. In this one, best example is this question number 7. Under the permanent settlement of 1973, the Jamindars were required to issue patta. So this is very interesting. Normally, come to know, in Rayatwari system and Mahalwari system, yes, pattas were issued. But what about the Jamindari system? Means the British instructed to issue the pattas to the peasants by the Jamindar, to the farmers, which were not issued by many of the Jamindars. So were required to issue the pattas, but many Jamindars didn't issue patta. This is the question. Now you come to what was the reason? The Jamindars were trusted by the farmers. Definitely it would not be there. Though the Jamindars were the local, were trusted by the farmers, they never trusted, because many a Jamindar were oppressed the farmers. Next, there was no official check upon the Jamindar. Yes, this seems to be the most probable. You just keep, because other options are there, you go through. It was the responsibility of the British government. No, you could easily eliminate this one. Only because of this, they introduced the Jamindari system. Because the British don't want to take the responsibilities, right? Only for this, they introduced the local people called the Jamindars. So, this third statement is absolutely wrong. Because here is the EIC, here the various Jamindars were there. Jamindars were there, under that the villages were given. So British don't want to take any responsibility of this, because of the administrative condition at the time existed only for this the British. So it was the responsibility of the British. No, it was responsibility of the Jamindars. So third statement is outrightly wrong. The farmers were not interested in getting patta. No, this is also absolutely wrong, because patta is given, you have the absolute title ownership. So this statement is wrong. Now we already marked that there was no official check upon the Jamindar. The Jamindar were trusted by the farmers. Definitely you could, by applying logic, you could eliminate this one. So most probable answer, there was no official check upon the Jamindars. Though you might not have come across this kinds of line in the books, but with applying the basic economic history, you could easily answer these kinds of questions. That's why nowadays these kinds of questions are being asked. So partly you have to study, partly you have to apply the logic inside the exam hall. So this is the best example. Next one, the last major extension of the Indian territory, British Indian territory, took place during the time of what, whose person, sir? This is what. So, British Indian Territory took place during the time. You all knew that 1588 Queen's Proclamation. In the 1858 Queen's Proclamation, one of the statement, they have enlisted various statement. One of the statement is no more annexation. Not only no more annexation, and the princely states were treated as a friend. So, before 1857 revolt and after 1857 revolt, that too after the Queen's Proclamation, the relationship between the British versus the princely state underwent change. Highly underwent change here is this. So, in Queen's Proclamation, no more annexation. With this, you could easily eliminate two or three options, because all major expansion took place only before 1857. In this, only one, Kazan is around 1900, Lord Lytton 1870s, Tufferin 1880s, and Dalhousie 1850s. So the only one person in this is the Dalhousie. So if you know the Queen's Proclamation, if you know the Queen's Proclamation, it's very easy to answer this question. You know, don't want the exact years of the Tufferin tenure, Lytton's and Cousins, just have an idea. This Dalhousie was highly responsible for annexing the company's territory, especially annexation of Punjab, annexation of various small territory by applying doctrine of lapse, and another annexation of Awadh by the doctrine of misgovernance. So this is one way of applying. That's why repeatedly I am saying that don't just by heart, rather than study the concept, yourself will come to know. So the question is, major extension of the British Indian Territory took place during which time? For that you must know the Queen's Proclamation. With this you could answer. Yes, this is one interesting thing already. It's a 2018. Which one of the following is a very significant aspect of the Champaran Satyagraha? So if you know the background and to whom Gandhiji was fighting, it's very easy to answer. Active all participation of the lawyers, students and women in the national movements. No, the women, students, lawyers started to participate in the Swadeshi movement itself. In 1905 itself, they started to participate. First time one could see the active participation of the women, students and lawyers in 1905. It's active involvement of Dalit and tribal of the Indians, that too somewhat late, that too with the rail of the Gandhiji, when Gandhiji took the social issues and these kinds of people, though more or like this is related to the Gandhian phase. Gandhian phase, 1920s. Second, third, joining of the peasant unrest into the Indian, yes, joining of the peasant unrest into the India's national movement, this is most the right one. And the drastic decrease in the cultivation of the plantation crop and the commercial crops. Yes, actually this C and D seems to be more or less, but here the answer is joining of the peasant unrest into the Indian national movement. It was after Gandhiji's. What's the significant aspect? Keep it in mind, because many students answered this also. So what is the significant aspect is peasants greatly started to participate in the national movement. Simple. First, Gandhiji and Indian nationalists started to support the peasant. Not only the peasants, the laborers and other people. After this, these peasants and the laborers started to support the nationalists and then started to support the national movement. This is what here happened. So, a drastic decrease in cultivation of the plant crops, it seems to be that, but it is not the answer to this. This is what slight confusion of many students while answering this C and the D. The right one is this. And again, very recent 2017 question, the Trade Dispute Act 1929 provided. Two things you must know. One is Trade Dispute Act, another is the Public Safety Bill, were moved and passed in 1929 in the Central Legislative Assembly. Against the passage of these two bills only, the two great revolutionary leader Bhagat Singh and another person called Badkeshwar Dutt, these two great young revolutionaries threw bomb into the assembly. Right, against, they wanted to show their anger against the passage of these two bills, the Trade Dispute Bill and the Public Safety Bill. Now what's the question is, the Trade Dispute Act provides for is the participation of worker in the management of the industry, arbitrary power of the management to quell the industrial dispute, and intervention by the British, a system of tribunal and ban strike. Yes, here the C is the right one. Actually, why these two young revolutionaries showed the anger mean, had this bill, that the Trade Dispute Bill later became Act, was passed, it would curb the strike. It's one of the democratic instrument, but British wanted to suppress that workers and the strike, workers movement and the strike. With that intention only, they introduced the bill, later became the Act, Trade Disputes Act. It's a one interesting thing. So on, so various restrictions were there before proclamation or before the workers were going for the strike. So participation of worker, that was not the aim of the British. British have never had such an intention. Arbitrary power of the manager, that was not, but you may consider this one, but it is not. Intervention by the British court in the event of a trade dispute. British had never such an idea to interfere into this. This is the most probable answer. So in this, Trade Dispute and Public Safety, that too, one other thing I must explain about this is 1920s, one could see the rise of the communism and socialism current in the Indian national movement, especially after 1917 Russian Revolution. After that, the revolutionary idea started to spread length and breadth of the colonial country, including India. That led to 1920s rise of communist and social current in Indian subcontinent. That led to the ultimate birth of the various socialism and communist party. So CPI, later Congress Socialist Party, even why not, many socialists were there, socialists were there within INC, Indian National Congress. Even socialism had an impact on the revolutionary also. That is the reason HRA later became HSRA. Here the word they included socialism. So if you know these kinds of basic thing, you could answer this and come to very interesting. There's sometimes question would be asked outside the Congress. No doubt 1885 to 1947, the major phase and major organization was Indian National Congress. But sometimes if you go through 1916, 1923 and 1930s and 1940s, other than Congress, other elements were there. Why 1916? Mean here home rule movement. Here 1920s, 22, that is Swaraj Party, and 1930s Congress Socialist Party, 1940s INA. So these are all other organization which worked out for the India's freedom struggle. In this one, such a question is related to the Congress Socialist Party. This has been asked recently. Now, come to the question. With reference to the Congress Socialist Party, consider the following statements. So, before entering into that, you should know the basic aspects of the Congress Socialist Party. Its origin is quite interesting. It was started in 1934. So, if 1934 mean, you should know that 1930 to 1934, civil disobedience movement, CDM took place. During CDM, almost all the leaders were arrested and put into jail, in various jail. That too, now the story start with the Nasik jail. In 1930s, some of the leaders, J. Prakash Narayan, Achyut Patwardhan, Acharya Narendra Dev, these people were in Nasik jail. They were influenced by the socialist ideas, because 1920s one could see the rise of the socialist ideas in across the world, especially after 1917 Russian Revolution. So such ideas influenced the Congress leader also, and what was the influence of the ideas was the starting of the party called Congress Socialist Party. So the word, each word and the party itself says within the Congress the socialist concept was started to rise. That's why it's a Congress Socialist Party. When CDM was over, all the leaders were arrested leaders were released. In 1934, this Jay Prakash Narayan, Acharya Narendra Dev, Achyut Patwardhan, these people came out and started an organization called Congress Socialist Party. Another quite interesting is this is not outside, this is within the Congress, because Jay Prakash Narayan himself mentioned that nothing is outside, nothing is against the Congress. If the Congress today failed to accept our view, tomorrow put forward that view before the Congress. If tomorrow also failed, day after tomorrow. So its organization worked within the Congress party and nothing against and nothing outside the Congress. You should know these kinds of the basic information related to the origin of the Congress Socialist Party. Now come to the choice. It advocated the boycott of the British good and evasion of the taxes. No doubt at all related to the boycott of the goods, but not related to the evasion of the taxes. So in this, if you go through the aim of the Congress Socialist Party, you could easily eliminate this. It wanted to establish the dictatorship of proletariat. In this connection only, it is slightly different from Communist Party. The Communist Party's aim wanted to have the dictatorship government, but not the Congress Socialist Party. So this is a major difference. Rather than they want democratic institutions, in accordance with the prevailing condition of the India, they ruled out the dictatorship of the proletariat. So second choice is wrong, because they wanted democratic establishment. It advocated separate electorate of minorities and oppressed class. No, because it always accepted the Congress view. Congress always opposed the separate electorate system. The same view was taken by Congress Socialist parties. That's why if you go through this, he could easily eliminate this part. Third choice one could easily eliminate. Now if you have a plain reading of the third choice, you straightly come to the answer. That's A, B, C and C. D, you could easily eliminate this, and you could easily eliminate this. Only thing is 1 and 2, it wanted to establish the dictatorship of proletariat. That's the difference between Congress socialist party and communist party. So from that, the two is ruled out here also. So what's the answer is this one. So basic aspect, because this Congress Socialist Party accepted all the Congress views, including the Gandhian. Instead of going for the revolutionary activities, it propagated the Gandhian mass movements, that too non-violence. This is the major difference between, another difference between the Communist Party and the Congress Socialist Party. So this is the method of study while studying the modern India. So when you started to study any of the organization, very similar to the Congress Socialist Party, you study the origin of the Home Rule Movement and what contest, both in internal and international circumstances, why such a Home Rule Movement was started, why the starting of the Swaraj Party, and why the starting of the Indian National Army. So with the background, if you know, even though if you don't know the statements, you could easily answer by this method. Next, we move on to the next one. It's a simple question. Quit India Movement was launched in response to. Actually, nowadays they are asking chronological order related question from 1940 to 1947. Because here the 7 years is the tumultuous years and various changes took place in the Indian National Movement. So 1940s to 1947, various events. Even sometimes you have to study not only yearly basis, sometimes you have to study on a month basis also. In this, Quit India Movement was launched in response to which of the following? Is one by one. Quit India, you people know very well that August 1942, that is the reason this Quit India Movement is also called August Revolution. So another important thing is Quit India Movement is also called August Revolution because it was started on August 1942. Okay, you know the basic concept. It was started on August 1942. It responds to what one, sir? In this cabinet mission, yes, exactly, just before the Quit India Movement, 1942, around March this place. Cripps proposals, cabinet mission was 1946, Cripps proposal 1942, Simon Commission report 1928, you could easily eliminate this one. Wewell plan is 1946. So if you know, even you don't want the exact year, just one is 1940s, one is 1930s, one is after the World War. So if you know, you could easily eliminate this choice. So you could easily eliminate this one, and you come to the remaining thing, cabinet mission, Cripps proposal, Wewell plan. This cabinet mission and Wewell plan were the post-war measures, automatically the Cripps proposals. So here one interesting thing is 1939, Second World War was started. Indians, that too the nationalist leader, refused to cooperate with the British. That's why in 1940 the British sent the government gave an offer called August Offer in 1940 by Lord Linlithgow. But dissatisfied with this only, Gandhiji started individual satyagraha. So after the failure of the August Offer by Linlithgow, Gandhiji started individual satyagraha in 1940. After that, both internal and international events happened. In 1942, the government has sent the Cripps mission, that led to the Cripps proposal, right? Even we expected a lot, but what we drew was nothing. That's why completely Gandhiji was dissatisfied, and what was the response was, he immediately started the Quit India Movement after the failure of the Cripps proposal. So this year, generally in 1940s to 1947, try to study in a chronological order. It will be highly helpful. Even one of the questions that we will discuss recently has been asked. So while studying this Quit India Movement, you should know what are all the events happened between 1939, even you keep it 1939 to 1947, then it's very easy. Next, the 14th question, the demand for the Debaha movement in Bengal was, sure, this is the peasant movement. Various peasant movement took place during the freedom struggle, especially 1850s. 1850s to 1947, various peasant movement took place. If you study like this, for example, if you study peasant movement and tribal movement, next the women in the national movement, then the upper class people in the national movement, so students in national movement, whenever you are going to study, you always have to study between 1850s to 1947. In mains, they are asking questions like this. Contribution of women, participation of women during the freedom struggle phase. And recently there is a question, participation of women, contribution of women during the Gandhian phase. Gandhian phase means after 1917. So while studying the women movement, while studying the peasant movement, tribal movement, and students in national movement, upper class people in national movement, next to the capitalist in national movement, working class people in the national movement, whenever such a questions are there, whenever such a topics are there, you have to study holistically 1850 to 1947. In this, one of the movement, the peasant movement, is the Debaha movement. Okay, various movements took place. Before entering into the Debaha movement and the choices, a brief idea related to the peasant movement. If you see, in 1850s itself, three peasant movements took place. The best example is the Indigo Revolt. Next is the Pabna movement. Next is the Deccan Uprising. So, in 1850s to 1870s, these three movements took place. Next, you come to the 1900s. In 1900, it is coincided with the national phase that to the Champaran Satyagraha. Another is the Kheda Satyagraha. So, here the three and here the two, all together five movements are there. And if you come to the 1920s, one could see the rise of the peasant consciousness that led to the rise of peasant organization. For example, UP Kisan Sabha was started. And next one is the Awadh. Awadh Kisan Sabha was started. So, and led to the rise of various leaders. So, here initially movement, later starting of the Sabhas. Kisan Sabha themselves started to provide the leadership. And next, if you come to the 1940s, one of the important movement is this Debaha movement. And another is the Telangana movement, Telangana peasant movement. And another movement in Kerala is Punnapura, Punnapura Vayalar incident. So, how many? You just check it. One is the Indigo Revolt. Next is the Pabna movement. Next is the Deccan Uprising. Next, 1920s, along with that Gandhian movement, Champaran Satyagraha, Kheda Satyagraha. Next, rise of the Sabhas, UP Kisan Sabha, that's Awadh Kisan Sabha. In 1940s, again three movement, Debaha movement, Telangana movement, Punnapura Vayalar incident. In this, one of the movement in 1945 is the Debaha movement in 1945 in the Bengal region. So, this is the basic of the Debaha movement. Now, you come to what was the demand. So, simple, if you go through Baha, you just split it. The Baha, the means that three. Baha means a portion, share. So, if you have the plain reading of this, yourself will come to know the reduction of the share of the landlord from one half to the one third. So, here itself, the answer is there indirectly. If you have, instead of studying it in a hard manner, you try to split like this words, yourself will have it. The grant of ownership of the land to the peasant as they were actual cultivator of the land. The uprooting of the Jamindari system and the end of the serfdom. The writing of all peasant debt. Yes, all it seems that all the four options seems to be right one. But what is the best thing is this one. Now, why one half to the one third is landlord. The landlords are called Chotedar. And the peasants were called Barga, called as Bargadar. So, this Chotedar provided the land to the Bargadar. Initially, the Chotedar demanded what one is 1/2 to the Chotedar, right, and 1/3 to these people. Earlier, what happened is 1/2 and these two 1/2. But who were the actual cultivator was? This Bargadar was the actual cultivator. But major portion, lion's share was taken over by the Chotedar because of just providing the land. So, in 1940s, the rise of peasants, that's why these peasants were demanding in 1945 that, no, we don't want one half, rather than we want 2/3 share crops and you take the 1/3. So, the reduction of the share of the landlord from 1/2 through 1/3. So, this would go to the landlord and this would be taken by the Barga. So, earlier 2/3, 1/3. Later 1/2, 1/2. Landlord and Bargadar. Now, that the Bargadars, that is the peasants, were demanding 2/3 and 1/3 should be given to the landlords. So this is what related to the Dibaha movement. So this is the most important movement just before the independence took place in the Bengal regions. So this is the method of studying. So all the options seems to be right, but the most correct one is A. So this is the method always study in a holistic approach. Yes, 15th. 15th one is very similar to the 14th one. In the 14th one, it is related to the peasants, peasant in the national movement and the peasants movement themselves in this Dibaha movement. Likewise, in the 15th, with reference to the Indian freedom struggle, Usha Mehta is well known. Here, the women's contribution to the national movements. Yes, no doubt, since 1800s to 1947, one could see the gradual participation of the women in the national movement. That too, with that Gandhian movement, one could see the tremendous rise of the women, both in participatory level as well as in leadership level. So initially in participatory level, later in leadership level. In 1800 itself, one could see in the Karnataka region, that's Rani Chennava, Rani Chinnamma participated. That is, uprising is called Kittur uprising. In 1820s itself, one could see the rise of Rani Chinnamma. So that's why she was famously called the Kittur Rani. So very famous. Next, you come to 1850s. In 1857, revolt, Lakshmibai, the great Lakshmibai participated, and Behram Hasrat Mahal participated. So likewise, while studying the peasant movement or the women's participation in the national, you have to study in a holistic manner. Then it will be more useful to understand whatever the question, you could easily answer. Even if you don't know direct by elimination process, you could answer this one. So now you come back to this. Kittur uprising, the Kittur Rani. Next is 1857, two women greatly participated, and even with the rise of Congress, especially with the rise of Gandhiji, one could see the women participation as well as in leadership level. The fine example is in 1930s civil disobedience movement, Sarojini Naidu actively participated. That too well known is the Darshana Salt Satyagraha. When Gandhiji was arrested, he was in jail. But Darshana Salt Satyagraha was performed by Sarojini Naidu. That's why Gandhiji himself told that, I am here, but my soul is with you. Here it denotes that Sarojini Naidu. And if you come to 1940s, during the Quit India movement, it's very interesting. Because throughout the movement, all the Congress leaders were arrested. When male members were arrested, it was a great thing of participation of the women. Many women participated and took the leadership. In that, one is Usha Mehta. Another is the Aruna Asaf Ali. Another is Suchita Kriplani. Another is Sarojini Naidu. All actively participated in this. Right. In this, Usha Mehta played a vital role. What's the contribution is? That's the answer. A is the answer. Running the secret radio station in the wake up of Indian National Movement. So this is the answer. Participated in the second roundtable conference, no, in no way related. Leading a contingent of the Indian National Army. Yes, that's a women contingent was there. That women contingent name is Rani Lakshmibai contingent. Actually, who led that women contingent in the Indian National Army was Lakshmi Shekhar. Lakshmi Shekhar led the women contingent, that to Lakshmibai contingent of the Indian National Army in this. Assisting the formation of the interim government under Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru. No, here women didn't give the participation. So in this, the answer is secret radio stations. Quite interesting thing is, some of the nationalist leader gave a daily speech to the common man through this secret radio station. That was the contribution of the Usha Mehta during the Indian freedom struggle. So not only Usha Mehta, various women participated. So that's, you have to do it. Once if you go through the modern India, in the national movement, you have to study 1850s to 1947. If you study like this, whatever the question, you could easily answer. So this is the method of study. Next, before entering into the next questions, a brief idea of studying the modern India. Some people are saying that, sir, I am studying it again and again, but I forget it. One thing is there. If you see the modern India, you could easily split the modern India into the broadly the three things. One is 1948 to 1750s. Next phase is the 1750s to 1857, and next phase is the 1857 to 1947. First set, you consider this like a phase 1, this is a phase 2, and this is a phase 3. Always, if you started here, you know very well that this is the coming of European. If you start to study here, you have to finish up to 1750s, continuous. One side is the coming of Europeans, other side is the rise of Mughals, other side is the two great kingdom in south, one is the Vijayanagar, another is the Bahmani kingdom. So you have to study likewise. So when European came to India, who are the our contemporary, if you study, you would never forget it. Next, 1750s to 1857, this is a pure of rise of English East India Company, no doubt at all. When the British started to rise, at the same time Mughal started to decline of the Mughal. But one started to rise. At the cost of the decline of Mughal, the British started to rise. At the same time, from the west coast, the Marathas also started to rise. And the rise of regional kingdoms. So, company, rise of Marathas and rise of regional kingdom. But ultimately, in this phase, 1750s to 1857, gradual rise of the company, and by 1847 become the undisputed power in Indian. So here only various wars, so on, so socio-religious reform movement, that you have to study that. And this phase is the pure national movement phase. In this, you have to study in a holistic manner. That's what I discussed earlier. So try to split the entire modern India into these three kind of phase. Then you study. Once you study 1950, 1948 to 1750, you stop it, try to solve the question. Next you come to the next phase, 1750s to 1847, you study and solve the question. Next 1847 to 1947, rather than continuously studying from 1498 to 1947. Now you come back to this one. That's the next question, 16th question. Here again, assassin and recent type. I already discussed this one. Now I straightly come to this. The Congress ministers in all the provinces resigned in the year 1939. Yes. But the reason means, keep one thing, 1939 to 1945, you have to study, 45, you have to study the events both happened internally and internationally as well as internationally. If you studied, because here the Second World War took place, this has a great impact on the Indian national movements. If you study like this, definitely you could answer like this questions. So now we come, Congress ministers in all the provinces resigned in 1939. The Congress didn't accept the decision. Reason, yes, Congress didn't accept the decision of the Viceroy to declare war against, here keyword is didn't accept, war against Germany in the context of the Second World War. Yes, no doubt, 1939, Second World War was started. In the same 1939, October 1939, all the Congress ministers were asked to resign. Why? That is what assassin reason. So what was the reason was, we are not at all rejecting the government decision to fight against the Germany. That was not at all questioned at all. We are ready to fight against the Nazi Germany, even because Gandhiji once said that when compared to the British imperialism, one is the British imperialism. If British imperialism was worse, Nazi aggrandism was the worst. So here he mentioned as the worst, here is the worst. These are all the keyword, British imperialism, Nazi aggrandism. That's why we are ready to support when the British was waging war against the Nazis. That's why not at all questions. Then what forced the resignation of the Congress minister is, when the British entered into war without opinion, without getting opinion or discussion or getting permission from the Indian leader, it dragged British Indian into the British side. This is what the Congress didn't accept. That led to the resignation of the Congress ministers. That's why assassin is right, October 1939, Congress ministers resigned. but reason was wrong. So you could straightly, assertion is right means either this or this. Now either of this, right? Now you come to the reason side. Reason is wrong. This is what the answer. A is true, but R is false. So this is the method of answering of assertion and reason type. Though it's not has been asked in recent last 8 years, these kinds of question may be surfaced. Next one, with reference to the Indian freedom struggle, which one of the following statement is not correct? So normally they would put like this, otherwise they would give it in a normal. You have to recognize like this. This is what the major mistake a student would commit it. They would not recognize like this. They would always consider the correct statement, but sometimes they would give incorrect statement. This is what such option would be there. Without knowing that, they would give answer to the correct one, but what is the question is incorrect, but and another thing is not correct one. So this is very important. Here we have given that not correct one in the bold letter, so the capital, that's why it's very easy to recognize. Now come to this. The Rowlatt Act aroused the way of popular indignation and led to the Jallianwala Bagh massacre. Yes, Subhash Chandra Bose formed the forward block. Bhagat Singh was one of the founder of the Hindustan Republic Socialist Association. In 1931 Congress session at Karachi opposed Gandhi Irwin Pact. So first plain reading, definitely one or two statement you come to know this is absolutely wrong, this is absolutely right. Now we will discuss. The Rowlatt Act aroused the way of popular indignation and led to the Jallianwala Bagh massacre. Yes, in this Rowlatt Act 1919, actually the year 1919 is very important in the national movement. So 1914 to 1918 First World War. After the First World War, we expected a lot from the British, because unlike the Second World War, all the Indian leader wholeheartedly supported the British effort in the First War, with expectation that after war we would be given a prize. But what we got is nothing. Rather than suppression and oppression, one of the suppression in the name of the Rowlatt Act. So one of the major thing in the initial years of 1919 is the Rowlatt Act. So Rowlatt Act happened. Against that only Gandhiji started Rowlatt Satyagraha. While doing that Satyagraha only, right, in Punjab people peacefully participated in Jallianwala Bagh. That led to the untoward instance, worst of all the case, that is the Jallianwala Bagh massacre. Yes, arose the wave that led to the Jallianwala Bagh massacre. A statement is the right. Subhash Chandra Bose formed the forward block. Yes, in 1939 Tripuri session was there. Subhash was elected as the president after winning the Gandhian nominee of Pattabhi Sitaramaya. Actually in 1939 there was election, one said Subhash Chandra Bose, other said Pattabhi Sitaramaya, the nominee of the Gandhi. In that Subhash Chandra Bose got victory. That led to some dispute within the Congress. Later Subhash resigned from the Congress, and in 1940 he started an organization called Forward Block. Full name is All India Forward Block. Yes, formed All India Forward Block. The second choice is right. Bhagat Singh was one of the founder of the Hindustan Republic Socialist Army. Yes, in 1928 at very famous place called Kotla, or called Feroz Kotla, now part and parcel of Delhi. In that he formed that. Earlier it was called as HRA, that is in 1924. Later HSRA, 1928. Bhagat Singh, Chandrasekhar Azad, Sukhdev, these people participated and formed the HSRA. So this is the right one. And in 1931, so what's the right answer? Because it's a not correct, this should be the answer. Why? Means in 1931, Congress session at Karachi opposed Gandhi Irwin Pact. So this is wrong because it accepted Gandhi Irwin Pact, it endorsed it. Then only Gandhiji went and attended the second round table conference. Here this is very interesting. In 1930 civil disobedience movement was started. So 1930s to 1934, In 1930, CDM was started. Most successful one. So Gandhiji, all other leaders were arrested. 1930s in the mid first round table conference. INC didn't participate. So no great impact. In 1931, for attending of second round table conference, Gandhiji was released. Gandhiji met the Viceroy, the then Viceroy Irwin. That was fruitful in 1931, that to the March M5. March 1931, Gandhi Irwin Pact was signed. After 2 weeks, exactly March 31, the Karachi session. Karachi session was held, Gandhiji attended, and it endorsed the Gandhi Irwin Pact. After that only Gandhiji went to attend second round table conference. So CDM was started. Initially Congress leaders didn't participate because all were arrested. In between the first RTC was held, no fruitful outcome. So for the attendance of the Congress, Gandhiji was released. Gandhiji met Irwin, that led to the Gandhi Irwin Pact. It was endorsed, that is accepted in at the Karachi session. So this Karachi session is very important. This is not a normal session. This is a special session. You must know the difference between normal session and special session. Actually, normal session means December month, last 3 days. Other than December month, right, if a session took place, that is the special session, it's a one important thing. Another important thing, who was the president of the Karachi session was Vallabhai Patel. That's why Karachi session play a vital role. So, in 1939, Karachi session, what's the first thing is Vallabhai Patel, the president. Second thing is Gandhi Irwin Pact was endorsed. And the third thing is fundamental rights. This is most important. Fundamental rights was accepted. That's why here the answer is D, because accepted the Gandhi Irwin Pact. Move on to the next one. An important aspect of the CRIPS mission in 1942. Yes, at the backdrop of the Second World War, it was going on between 1939 to 1945. August offer was provided, but it was rejected by INC and Muslim League, and Indian leaders refused to cooperate, full-fledged cooperate with the British war effort. It's a great setback to the British. Other side, after Pearl Harbor incident, the rise of the Japanese forces, and already the Japanese started to attack and started to capture this area, and they were decided to attack the Indian region. Had they attacked, captured the Indian region, it was a great setback to the British. So that's why the British government decided to send a mission to India with the Stafford Cripps, called the Cripps mission. So with this backdrop, with this background, we are going to approach the choice. What was the important aspect? So for what purpose Winston Churchill government sent Stafford Cripps mission, that we will discuss. That all Indian states join the Indian Union as a condition to consider the degree of autonomous. All Indian states, it never mentioned. Actually, in UPSC exam, some keywords are there, all. Next is the no. Next is only. Next is the major. Next is the none. So these are all the keywords. If these kinds of keywords are there in a statement, in a question, you have to take uttermost care. So in this, that all Indian state, no, this statement is absolutely wrong. This was not the provision. If you go through, definitely you come to know. The creation of Indian Union with the dominion status very soon after the Second World War. Yes, let us consider this one. Active participation and cooperation of Indian people, communities, political parties in the British was a foot. British, actually it's a war effort, as a condition for granting independence with full sovereign state after war. Actually, this is absolutely wrong, because the Winston Churchill government was not at all ready to give the sovereign state, that is a independence. So if you go through the British attitude during the war period, Second World War period, you could eliminate this answer. So first is eliminated, C is eliminated. Framing of the constitution for entire Indian Union with no separate constitution. So that's why I said here one important word is no separate constitution for any provinces and Indian territory. This is absolutely wrong, because the provision says that a constitution would be set up if any of the province didn't want to join in the constituent assembly, didn't accept the constitution, mean such a provinces were allowed to form a separate constitutions. So this provision is the hint of providing partition. Actually here no separate constitution for any province. Actually this statement is wrong. What is the right statement here is, if any of the provinces wanted to have a separate constitution, they are allowed. So this is contradiction to the GRIPS proposal. The most apt one is the creation of Indian Union with the dominion status. Yes, British intention in 1940s was ready to give the dominion status, but the problem is not in 1940s, soon after the second war. So this is the right one. So and what background GRIPS mission was sent, and what were the aspects of the GRIPS mission, whether GRIPS mission was accepted or not, what was the impact of the GRIPS mission? Because it was not at all accepted by Congress, that's why Gandhiji started Quit India movement. That's one of the question that we earlier discussed it. So here 18th question, answer is the B. Now come to the next one. During the Indian freedom struggle, the Kudai Kitmat Kars, also known as Red Shirt, called for. Yes. Sir, who are the Kudai Kitmat Kar mean? It's the Pashto language. The Pashtun Pathan people are there in northwestern frontier province. In the Pashto language, Kudai Kitmat Kar, the English translation is servants of gods. So Kudai Kitmat Kar means servants of the gods, also called the Red Shirt. Actually, it was started very earlier. It was more or like it's a social organization. In what way they helped the people in northwestern frontier region, tribal people mean construction of the educational institutions, social welfare measures. So their early work was this one, that is related to the social activities. When it had contact with the Indian National Movement, that too with the Gandhian idea, it accepted the Gandhian values and actively participated under the great leadership of Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan, who was also called as the Frontier Gandhi. So Kudai Kitmat Kar, what is the meaning? What was the earlier work in northwestern frontier region? Now it is called Khyber Pakhtunkhwa region of the Pakistan. So with this basic information, you come to this. The Union of Pashtun Tribal Area in, yes, it's the Pashtun tribal area of northwestern Afghanistan. It's not northwestern Afghanistan, in the northwestern Pakistan region. It's a social organization. First statement is wrong. The adoption of terrorist tactics and method for terrorizing and finally ousting the colonial. That's why I discussed it accepted the Gandhian value. So this statement is outrightly rejected. The adoption of communist revolutionary idea for political and social reform. Yes, it seems to be correct, because here is the Russia is there. Here the Central Asian, in this the Afghanistan and the Pakistan area, many had an influence of the Russian, but not this one. So it seems to be right, but this is not. The Pathan regional nationalist unity and the struggle against the colonialism. This is the right one. It completely supported the Indian National Congress and the Gandhian method ideas, even actively participated during the civil disobedience movement, even participated in the Quit India movement, and its leader Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan was arrested. So this is the right one, 19th one. Again, who among the following organized the famous Chittagong Armory Raid? This question is related to the revolutionary nationalism. Before entering into the question and answer, a brief related to the revolutionary nationalism or revolutionary terrorism, it is better to use the word revolutionary nationalism, and all are our nationalists. So if you see in 1850s to 1947, here and there one could see the rise of revolutionaries. Whenever the Congress was in the lowest ebb, one could see the rise of the revolutionary nationalism. It would be like this. For example, in 1922 non-cooperation movement. After Maj, after that 1930-1934 CDM. After that 1942 to 45 quit India movement. In between gap 1922 to 1930, 1934 to 1942, if you see in this area, one could see the rise of revolutionary nationalism. Here one could see the rise of revolutionary nationalism. Even before that, 1905 to 1907, here is the Swadeshi movement phase. So 1907 to 1970s, 20s, one could see the rise of revolutionary nationalism. So whenever Congress was in active phase, all would concentrate. When it was in that passive mode, so rise of the revolutionary nationalist. So phase 1, here phase 2, here one could see the rise of phase 3. In this revolutionary nationalism phase 2, two group of people were there. In that, one of the group is the Bengal group. In that Bengal group, organization called Indian Republican Army. So don't confuse with Indian National Army that was started by Subhash Chandra Bose. Here is the Indian Republican Army started by a famous leader called Surya Sen. So these people contacted the Chittagong Army because as a revolutionary organization, they wanted weapon to fight against the British. What they did, they straightly went and started to loot the armory godown. In this, IRA conducted the Chittagong Army raid. So who was the head means Surya Sen. This is the answer. B is the answer. Then what about the other people, sir? Lakshmi Shagal, as we already discussed that, she was the head of the women contingent of the INA. The women contingent name was called Lakshmi Bai contingent. We already discussed that. That Badkeshwar Datta, he was related to the HSRA. HSRA along with Bhagat Singh. One interesting thing is, in 1929, the assembly bomb throwing case, he along with Bhagat Singh threw bomb into the Central Legislative Assembly. So he was related to HSRE. And what about J.M. Sen Gupta, a leader from Chittagong and a well-renowned leader in Assam region, a revolutionary leader, a lawyer, and many a time he was arrested. So he was also a revolutionary leader from the Bengal and the Assam region. Very famous in 1920s. In this, the answer is Surya Sen, except Lakshmi Shagal. Here all are related to the revolutionaries. Lakshmi Shagal is related to Indian National Army. What is the correct sequence of the following event? So as I said earlier, if you go through August offer, INA trail, Quit India Movement, Royal Indian Navy, Naval Rating. So August offer, no doubt at all, exactly August 1940 by Lord Linlithgow. INA trial is November 1945. Quit India Movement 1942 to 1945. Royal Indian Naval Rating Mutiny is Feb of 1946. As I said earlier, between 1939 to 1947, you have to study various events because nowadays questions are being asked to arrange you in a chronological order. That's why if you know August offer, INA, with this you could easily come to know what is the first thing is the August offer. Here with this only these two alone are there. It's very easy to come. Next, after that, the 3, 1942 to 45. Yes, here 1, 3. Next only you have to check what would come at first, 2 or 4. It's very easy that 2 would come because November 1946. So this one and last is Feb 1947. A is the answer. So this is a method of arranging anything in a chronological order. So even if you don't know exact years, just to have after this event, this took place. After this, this took place. Because nowadays they are asking question in a chronological order from 1939 to 1947. Next. Economically, one of the results of the British rule in India in 19th century was. So here, whenever you are studying about economic history, we always keep it in mind. One thing, you must know. Whenever it's a economic history means 1750s. So before 1750s, after 1750s. Political wise, I discussed 1948 to 1750s, 1750s to 1850s, 1857 to 1947. Economic wise, before 1750s, after 1750s. Here 1498, here is 1947. So in this, why 1750s was, two things happened. One is British started to conquer. At the same time, outside is industrial revolution was started in Britain. So that took place around 1750s. So before 1750s, now just confined to the economy, before 1750s, there was no industrial revolution, that was no machine age in throughout the world, rather than through all practiced the handi, depends on handicraft industries. Both in Britain as well as in India, we had a great achievements in the handicraft industries before 1750s. Our handicraft industries are far superior when come to the, compared to the British. That's why many European came to India and purchased our product, not the raw material, it's a finished product. That's why before 1750s, balance of trade was always favorable to India. So that is the reason Jahangir, Akbar, Shahjahan gave grants of setting up of the companies to them, because it's a favorable to us. But throughout the world, just handicraft industries were there. So it was a great opportunity. That's why during Shahjahan period, trade revolution took place in Indian subcontinent. Even the British and the Europeans started to lament that. What kind of lament means? One famous statement is there, after the traveling of the gold and silver bullions, at last it sink into a country called India. So balance of trade was favorable to India. But after 1750s, when industrial revolution was started, the commerce trade and commerce position was completely changed. We started to export raw material and we started to import the finished goods. But here, finished goods were exported before 1750s, but here raw material mean related to the agriculture. It agriculture means whether food crops or cash crops, means all are the cash crops, cotton, jute, tea, coffee, this thing. This was one of the impact of the British after 1750s and continued till 1947. So these things you must know, that led to the commercialization of the Indian agriculture. So what is commercialization mean? Instead of cultivating the food crops, cultivating the cash crop is called the commercialization. So with this 19th century, that's why before 1750s means different, here 19th century means 1800 onwards. With this, let us increase the export of Indian handicraft. No, absolutely wrong, because when industrial revolution was started, raw material was exported, finished goods were imported. What happened? Complete destruction of our handicraft industries. Complete destruction of our handicraft industries, because we couldn't sustain before the industrialized Britain. The growth of number of Indian-owned factories, that's wrong. The growth of number of British-owned factory, that to subservient to the Indian economy, that's absolutely wrong. Commercialization of the Indian agriculture. Yes, that's what we discussed. This is the right answer. Rapid increase to the urban population. So this is the right answer, but I must discuss the fourth choice also. Actually, this is wrong. Rapid increase of the rural population rather than the urban population. It's logical outcome. Whenever handicraft industries were started to decline, people started to abandon such cities and lost job and started to settle in village, started to perform agriculture. That produced one impact called ruralization. Ruralization of the Indian demography. So instead of urbanization, during the British period, India witnessed ruralization. So these were the impact of the British rule. One is end of handicraft industry, that is called deindustrialization. Deindustrialization. Second thing is commercialization. And third thing is ruralization. So these three things were the direct impact of the British rule in India, that too after industrial revolution. So in this, always by heart these three things: deindustrialization, commercialization, ruralization. This is one of the impact. So political wise, phase are three. Here economy wise, here 1750s, it's good for India. After 1750s, complete destruction of the, our industries. Now this recent 2018 question, consider the following statement. First democratically affected party, that's a communist party government, was formed in the Indian states. affected party. It's a communist one in the Indian state. Yes, no doubt. The Kerala in 1957 election. That to the second general election. No doubt. This question is related to the post-independence and consolidation part. In this first democratically affected communist party, it's not commitment, communist party was formed in a state. The state is Kerala in 1957, the second general election. Why not in first general election? Actually, first general election was held in 1951-52. At the time, there was no state reorganization. There was no southern four state. Rather than all were called as the Madras state. That's all. There was no Kerala. There was no Mysore state. There was no Andhra Pradesh. Rather than all were part and parcel of the Madras state. That's why, right, in 1951-52, Congress got majority in this area, but 1957, after State Reorganization Commission, that is Fasilali Commission, Kerala was created, Mysore state was created, Andhra Pradesh was created, and the remaining is called Madras state. So with this, all the four southern states faced the election. In this 1947, the communist captured power in Kerala. The great leaders called Nambudripad. He was Nambudripad, became the first communist leader and to become the chief minister in Kerala. So 1957. India's then largest bank, Imperial Bank of India, was renamed as State Bank of India. This took place around 1955. So what happened? Earlier it was called, when it was started in 1920s, it was called as Imperial Bank. Later in 1955, it was renamed as State Bank of India in 1955. Actually, even the Imperial Bank was not actually started in 1920s. Earlier, what happened is, it was the Bank of Madras, Bank of Provincial Bank of Bombay, and Provincial Bank of Calcutta. These three were merged and called as Imperial Bank, started to function in 1920s. In 1955, it was renamed as State Bank, so in 1955. Air India was nationalized and became the carrier in 1956. Goa became the part of the independent India in 1962 because the Portuguese were adamant to leave it. That led to the army operation. That army operation is called Operation Vijay. After that army operation in 1962, that otherwise just you keep it 1960s liberated Goa. So with this you could easily, one is in 1955, now this one is in 1955 and this one is 1956. So if you go through that first thing here, so three is the right one. And next you come to whether 2 or 1 is the 2. Yes, 2 is the right. And next 1955, 1956. Next is 1957, 1. And last Goa became the part in 1960s, this one. So answer is B. So you no need to always remember the exact year. Just to have an idea. So first time in 2018 and 19, they started to ask more number of questions from the PIC part also. Just go through the PIC part along with the polity, questions may be asked. So try to study modern India in this way. If any question is asked related to CDM, that is in 1930, Quit India Movement or Indian National Army, don't just study that year also alone. You just to go back to the 5 years before, what happened in 1925 to 1930. Then it's very easy to understand CDM. Once CDM is over in 1934, you just what impact did it produce? If you study likewise, many students would concentrate if CDM or NCM in just that year, 1930 to 1934, in non-cooperation movement, 1922 to 1922. Just to go back 5 years before and what kind of impact it produced. If you study like this, you will have the great continuity and you no need to byheart the years again and again. Never byheart the years again and again. Rather than continuity is the logic and it's a magic to open the key of the prelims, definitely you could clear in this. So I think this session would be useful to you people, and once again I wish you all the people for your prelims exam do very well. Thank you.